the presentation by Nicolaus Floratos on tips and tricks for writing the successful ERC proposal.
Okay, I welcome you all to this session that we're going to talk about ERC and how we're going to develop successful proposals. Now, I will be looking sometimes to the camera, to the audience here with eye contact, and I will try to do my best on doing it. So thank you, Nolene, for uploading it. Now, one thing that you will notice with this training is that there are a lot of slides. I mean, we have something like 133 slides in 1 hour and a half, so that's a challenge, isn't it? Well, it is, but for one reason. And what is that reason? The reason is that I would like to give you the recipe, a detailed recipe, how you're going to be successful in an ERC proposal. We've watched a lot of interesting sessions this morning on ERC. So now we're going to complete this by giving you a detailed recipe. And as in all the recipes, what we have, we need to have ingredients, and we need to put the ingredients in a specific order, one by one. And the best thing is what? As long as the recipe is a detailed one, as long as the recipe has been tested, you don't need to remember it. So that's why these 133 slides are not for you to remember it, but you need to make sure that you understand everything that we discuss. So if you don't understand anything that we have on the projector, then please raise a question through the Zoom facility. It's very important. If you do understand the recipe, then you will be able to apply it. So that's what I'm just asking from my side. Now, as you will see, I will be wearing a lot of different hats. The first hat is that I'm a trainer and a coach, and I've initiated the Funding Expert Academy for that. Even if you Google Funding Expert from your place, wherever you're based, you will see my academy or my name popping up first. This is because of the high value of content that I provide to the community, to the ones that are interested to exploit European funds. I have been in this business, and so I'm wearing also the hat of the applicant since 1997. So that's 23 plus years so far. I'm now 48, 49 years old. So I started at the age of something like 26, I think. I don't remember. It's that old, so you can imagine. I'm also an expert on behalf of the European Commission for more than 17 consecutive years. So I will give you also wearing the hat of the evaluator, how the evaluators think, and trying to give you the perspective, although I'm not a panel member, also how the panel members or the remote referees think. And I'm also, the recipe that I said to you, the one that I'm going to discuss, it's not my own recipe. It's a recipe that I did by modeling how successful applicants are, what kind of practices they are applying in order to complete a successful and a winning ERC proposal. And this is what I'm really doing for you. It's like modeling and seeing how the best chefs create a very nice meal. And then I took a combination of all this and I tried to create a recipe in order to combine all the best practices that all the successful chefs have been doing in order to prepare a winning proposal or a delicious meal. I have been, the last 10 years, I'm wearing also the hat of the trainer. Training and coaching is my passion. I've been doing that, I think, since 2009. So I'm wearing also the hat of the trainer. And I'm going to give you the experience also on from that perspective. If you check my also my LinkedIn account, you will see more than 500 LinkedIn recommendations and endorsements as funding expert, as a coach, a research innovation coach. And this is because my students are actually sharing and are willing to give recommendations regarding the help that I'm giving them. I'm an engineer. I'm an electronic engineer with a master in telecommunications from Imperial College. However, I have also an MBA from the National Technical University of Greece and Business School of Greece, AWEP. And very recently, I got a different degree that is from social science and humanities, and that is on European culture and Greek culture, just for hobby, but that gave me a perspective to see things from a different point of view. And this is something, as you will see, and as the speakers discussed this morning, is very important for a winning ERC grant application. Next one is that I believe that with the proper training and coaching, anyone can master anything. So this is something that you don't need to be afraid of. We hear and we know that ERC grant applications are very challenging ones. And only the top researchers, the excellent researchers, will get funded. Well, yes, even Nobel Prize winners are not getting funding, as we've seen this morning. However, with the proper training, you will be able to reflect and convince how excellent your idea is and how excellent your scientific profile is. Because these are the two just elements that you need to prove for a winning ERC grant application. And this is what we will try to do in 1 hour and a half, and less than that. I just submitted my PhD on student engagement and online courses. I've started that 7 years ago. No one was aware that we will be facing that kind of pandemic now, but it seems to be very popular in nowadays. So I'm just going to defend it this autumn. But from all these different hats, the one that I'm really, really proud of, and the one that I believe it's very essential in our training, is that I am a master on taking complex issues, let's say how to create a complex food, and decomposing it into easy to apply, easy to understand, and easy to apply steps. And this is exactly what we're going to do here, because any training that we have, and if some of you have been attending to some of my trainings, you will see that all my trainings are based on recipes. I'm giving you the step-by-step actions and practices that you need to apply in a specific order in order to be successful. So this is what we will do also in this training. If you want to connect with me, these are my contact details. You will have access to the PDF or to the slides of that. So you will be able to connect. The best way to connect with me is through LinkedIn. Why? Because LinkedIn is the one that I'm checking personally. My training, the email address that you have, of course, I'm checking it, but no, I'm not the only one. I have an assistant for that. But if you want to interact with me directly, please make sure that you connect with me through LinkedIn. So now I've talked about the recipe. So let's see now, what is that recipe? The step-by-step recipe on submitting a successful ERC proposal. Now, there are three steps, as I keep on saying. The first step, and before going to the first step, we need to understand where we stand, where we are. Everyone before submitting or writing a proposal in ERC is wondering, what is high gain, high gain, high risk? What is groundbreaking? What is a breakthrough? What is scientific excellence? What is a novelty? How can I open new horizons? These are things that grant application writers are thinking when they are writing the proposal. And this is most of them we've seen as challenges in the panel's morning session that we had today. So from that point, in order to go to the stage that you are fully, fully confident on how to write an ERC successful proposal, there are just three steps, only three steps. So which are these steps? The first one is I want you to understand the intelligence behind ERC. And what is the keyword here is intelligence. What do we mean with intelligence? Intelligence is not confidential information, but public information that in many cases is underestimated, undervalued, but it is very, very precious. And we need to take it in our advantage. So we need to understand what we mean with intelligence in that respect. So this is the first step. And I call it ERC intelligence. The next step is that we need to be fully familiar on how we initiate a great idea, because you've seen also this morning that it's important to have a great idea up to the point that you submit the proposal. What are the intermediate actions that you need to undertake in a specific order? And this is, as I call it, the I create system. And you will see. And as soon as we master also that full proposal development cycle on ERC, then we need to master one more thing. And that is to know how we're going to impress the evaluators, the panel members, and the external referees in our case. So I call it the criteria formula. And that's it. You don't need anything else. You just need to master these three different steps. So let's see them one by one. So the first one, the first module, as I keep on saying, is intelligence on ERC. Now, first of all, I want you to understand why we have ERC. Why is it important to understand that? Because your proposal needs to reflect the purpose of the ERC. There is no way that you're going to get funded if you don't understand why we have ERC funding allocated to you as a principal investigator. So the first one is that the first reason why we have ERC is that it needs to support the best of the best in Europe across many different fields. And I would like to emphasize the word the best of the best researchers. It doesn't mean that you are the best of the best researcher, but you need to show that you are one of the best researchers. And this is the important thing. So this is what you need to know how you are going to show to the panel members. I repeat, you don't need to be the best out of the best, but you have to show that you are one of the best. So this is something that you need to reflect in the proposal. The second one is, first of all, we talk about bottom-up frontier research. What is frontier research? Frontier research means new research and useful research. We've seen also this morning from, I think it was from Alina, the ERC scientific officer, ERC Council officer, that she said that we don't want only something new. We want also something with high value. So this is important that we need. This is what we mean with frontier research. These are things that are copy and paste from the ERC. Huh? And I'm explaining to you what we mean with that. Now, the third one is, of course, as I said, it's an elaboration of what we said at the first purpose, that we need to have top research leaders. So you don't need only to be one of the best researchers, but you need to show the way how research should be conducted. So you need to be a leader. And that should be reflected not only in an advanced grant, but also in a standing grant, which is the first grant that an ERC can fund early stage researchers. Now, the next thing that we need is that ERC, we have it for great research ideas. Mm-hmm. So your research idea, and we will discuss about that, what makes a great idea is the starting, and to my view, an end point in a successful ERC. And last but not least, we need overall, as Europe, to raise the name, the prestige of European research in the whole world. So when you are talking about top researchers, we need to show that we are going to become top researchers, not only in Europe, but globally, whenever we suggest something. So these five reasons of why we have ERC are actually giving us the first thing that we need to consider when we write a proposal on ERC. So remember these five elements. So this is public information, we need to have it. I'm not going to talk about the eligibility criteria because we have already the speakers that talked about that. Now, for the starting and the consolidator, this is what I just have to say for the people that are watching the recording session. You need to add one more year because we are talking about 2022 submissions. We don't have any more calls, as we've seen this morning, on 2021 for with deadline in 2021 for starting grant and consolidator grant. So in that case, you need to add one more year in the eligibility. I'm not going to talk about the main grant schemes. I just have it here for the sake of complementarity, because the previous speakers exhausted that quite well. However, what I'm going to discuss about are the evaluation criteria. And as we've seen this morning, we have just two evaluation criteria. Which are these? One is the scientific excellence of your proposal, and the next, which is, as you see in the screen, the left-hand side. And the next criterion is the scientific excellence of you as a researcher. So these are just the two ones. So what kind of things we need to show in our proposal for, let's say, for the scientific excellence, the left-hand side, as we see. So one thing is that you will see to what extent the proposed research address important challenges. What is a challenge? Challenge is a problem. When we are missing some knowledge in a specific area, that's a challenge. So we need to give answers to what we're missing. And this is very linked with the importance of our proposal. Why it is important to have an ERC, that specific ERC idea funded? Because it addresses specific challenges. So that's the first thing. The other thing is you will see that is linked with the objectives and the state of the art. Now, let me tell you one tip here. We've seen today that it's very important from the other speakers to analyze the state of the art analysis. Why? Because the more clear you are with the state of the art analysis, the easier will be to come up with what? With your objectives. There is no way to start thinking about the objectives of your project just in your mind without having a very detailed and in-depth concrete analysis of what is the state of the art analysis. And not only that, even if you have done that during the proposal preparation phase, as we've seen this morning, during the interview session, you will have to update yourself. Because by the time you submit the proposal, up to the point that you are invited for an interview, you might have a break of 5-6 months. During those 5-6 months, you need to see whether there were any further developments and publications in your research topic. Because as we've seen, you will receive a question about them. And if not, you need to address it in advance without even being asked. So it is very important to have very good knowledge of the state of the art analysis. The stronger is your knowledge of your state of the art analysis, the stronger are your objectives. That simple. So this is your starting point. And that actually is aligned with the novelty. How new your research idea is. So we combine the importance with the novelty. Novelty is new. Important is the high value related. Now, the next one is on the high risk, high gain. We keep on hearing that high risk, high gain proposal. So I will give a little bit more clarification on that because it's a little bit confusing for some people. But high, let's say, from the high gain point of view, you need, first of all, to show what will be the impact, the positive impact to the scientific community and to the society. So this is related to the high gain. And when we say new horizons, what does that mean? Because this is also related to the impact. New horizons are related to how your proposal will show the way for new discoveries, not necessarily by you, but by others. So this is actually something that you need to think of. When you are contributing and you need to show that you have high value, high gain from your research project, not necessarily by you. So you need to show the way. Do we need to open the horizons for other applicants, for other scientists to exploit your project? Now, regarding the scientific approach, we need to show that the way that we're going to do it, the implementation is challenging. I mean, it's not a straightforward one. The methodology, the research methodology that you're going to follow in order to achieve what? The groundbreaking objectives that you have identified before based on the state of the art analysis, you need to show in a concrete way how you're going to deal with them, how you're going to develop those groundbreaking objectives, those groundbreaking results. So you need to work on the methodology also. But at the same time, on one hand, you have challenge implementation. Why you have challenge implementation? Because it's high risk, high gain. So yes, you will the overall idea might not be achieved, but at the same time, you need to show some feasibility. And this is where some researchers are feeling a little bit stuck. And we've seen that also in the panel discussion. What do we mean with that? We mean that even if your breakthrough idea is not fully achieved, at the very end, it will be feasible to have some results that are going to be still of high value. This is how we combine the challenging implementation, which is the high risk on one hand, with the feasibility on the other hand. And if you've seen, I think the lady from Croatia, from University of Split, she said that in the panel discussion, that I didn't address the high risk. What she said is that I made sure in my proposal that even if I don't reach the breakthrough idea, I will still be able to produce some objectives and some results of high value. So that was linked, and that was a very good comment, because this is what ERC wants. I mean, you're not going to receive 1.5 million or 2 million or 2.5 million euros and this to go in vain. ERC wants some concrete results of high risk, the breakthrough overall idea, but at the same time, at the very least, to produce some results of high value. So I'm clarifying that and I'm repeating that. Why? Because this is what is a question mark for a lot of researchers in many cases. The next thing is, of course, all these are on feasibility, so we discussed about that. And now we have some concepts that I would like to clarify from the scientific excellence point of view that are still a question mark for PIs. Even the ones that have been successful in some ERC grants, and then from the study grant, they go to consolidator grant, they still haven't make it that as clear as they could. So what is the difference between a breakthrough and groundbreaking? Because we have those two terms used but for different purposes in an ERC evaluation and also in the guide for applicants. So I would like you, when we are talking about a breakthrough, is exactly to imagine that photo here. What is that photo that you see on the screen? Breakthrough, you see that we have a seed that is a great seed that is so strong that in some cases manages even to go through the to break something and go above. So your breakthrough should be your overall idea. Your overall idea should be something that disrupts the scientific community. This is what we're doing here. We are disrupting the scientific community. We had something in flat, and then we disrupt that flatness, that emptiness, by seeing one plan raising up. This is the breakthrough. And what is groundbreaking? Groundbreaking, on the other hand, is not related to your idea, but is related to your objectives, which means to your results. So what does that mean? That means that still, if you didn't manage to fully achieve your breakthrough idea, as we said before, you will still be able to have some results that they are of high value and they are new. We haven't done them. We haven't seen such results before. So this is the groundbreaking nature. So breakthrough is an idea that penetrates the current knowledge limitations. What currently is flat is the current knowledge limitation. We don't know something else. So it penetrates it, and by the end of the ERC project, expects to lead to an important discovery. We expect to see the flower blooming. This is what we expect to see. On the other hand, groundbreaking are not the idea, the overall idea, but what? The objectives, which, as we said before, we have the objectives from the state-of-the-art analysis, that during the ERC project, they disrupt the current state-of-the-art, what we currently know. And the breakthrough idea is about your research idea. As a reminder, that is high risk. It can be done or it cannot be done because it's very ambitious. So that's why we don't know it. It is related to a key challenge, one key challenge, not many, one key challenge that you need to find. That is the big issue. So this is the big research question that you will address. For example, curing Alzheimer's disease. That is your breakthrough idea. Related to a challenge is a problem that can be of theoretical nature, conceptual, and not only of applied nature. It's up to you because, as you've seen in ERC, we don't focus only on applied research, but also on conceptual research or theoretical research. And it is we don't know what we will have at the end because it's highly ambitious. No one has done it so far. So it is of an unknown outcome. So it's a breakthrough. And it can also be novel to the research community, as it is often to social humanities. The other thing is that your breakthrough idea, as we've said, should show the way for new discoveries by others, not necessarily by you. So this is what we have, new research horizons, not only from your research community in your research topic, but also in other ones. This is the multidisciplinary aspect that we need to think of. On the other hand, the last thing is we don't want our breakthrough idea to be incremental research. And this is something that many people are failing, which is you've achieved something now, so you would like to have a follow-up project to advance further your results. No. Incremental research means that as soon as you achieve something there, you go there. One step further or two steps further. In ERC, you're expecting 5 years to go from there up there. So no incremental research regarding your idea is something that will advance the existing knowledge significantly. On the other hand, regarding the groundbreaking nature, as we said, groundbreaking is linked with the project objectives. So they need to be ambitious goals, but not of high risk. That's the important element. Why? Because we need at the very end to produce something concrete. You cannot get 5 million euros and not produce something. Your overall idea can be a breakthrough, can be of high risk, and cannot never be achieved. But the intermediate results that we expect to see during that process should be concrete, but at the same time ambitious. Are beyond definitely the state of the art. They need each one of those objectives should be answering, should be part of the big research question. So all these three ones or four ones, normally these are the number of objectives that we have on an ERC project, should be parts of the answer to the big research question. Not logically, of course, of high risk nature, as we've said. And we've seen on that also this morning how important that is. We need to have some preliminary evidence. This morning from Alina, it was called preliminary findings. Even if they are not published, still you need to explain them for many reasons. But the most important one is to show that your objectives have some basis. They are ambitious, but they are not of high risk. In order to show that, you need to show some evidence that this can be done. So this is based on the preliminary findings. Now, one thing regarding high risk and high gain. We've seen that concept that has been extensively mentioned by the panel discussion this morning, by the National Contact Point, by them, Alina also. So in order to understand that, I would like you to match the word gain with knowledge. So whenever you see the word high gain, that means high knowledge. And when we see the word knowledge, that means not only something new, but something that can be applied, something that can be useful also, something that gives answer to something that we don't know. So this is the gain thing. And I would like you to visualize risks as unknown territories. So the high risk, high gain is high knowledge And it is risky because we will be exploring, we'll be navigating as navigators, as explorers to unknown territories. No one has done that before. So that's why we don't know the outcome of it. We don't know what we will discover at the other side of the sea. We don't know what exists there. However, we have some assumptions that it will be something valuable. So this is what we want you. So the higher the knowledge that you're going to produce, the higher is the gain. The higher the knowledge, the higher is the gain. The higher are the unknown things, the unknown territories, what we currently do not know, based on the state-of-the-art analysis, the higher is the risk. So by doing this simple matching, immediately you give an answer to what we mean with high risk, high gain. Non-incremental research. I will allow you, when we think about non-incremental research, to think about a staircase that instead of going to first step and second step, we go up to the last step. This is what we want to achieve with non-incremental research. This is what we want to achieve with ERC, to advance knowledge that high that no one can challenge us that this is incremental research. It's a follow-up. Now, I'm not going to go through this checklist, but for me, that checklist that is not mine, is just from a special publication, is very useful. What? To see what makes an idea or a project of high value from the scientific point of view. So from the type of content, from the main finding, from the research, whether it is novel, innovative, from the research methodology, whether it is interdisciplinary or multidisciplinary, and from the research potential impact. There are some specific questions that you need to answer. My tip, my advice is when you're, even before completing and submitting your ERC proposal, to go through that checklist and says, okay, is it addressing a gap in existing knowledge? Yes, tick. Is it presenting new data or making new data sets available? Tick. Is it advancing a new theory? Tick. Is it synthesizing existing knowledge? Yes. Is it methodological development or technical innovation? Tick. And you need to have checks in all each one of them. So we have something like 5, 10, 14, 18, and then I think it's 24. 24 checks that we need to make sure that are valid by us, and then ask someone else to do that exercise for us also, because maybe we're a little bit biased on that. So this is regarding the scientific excellence. What about the scientific excellence of the principal investigator? So in what extent you can conduct research, groundbreaking research? What does that mean? Research beyond the state of the art. You need to show that. You need to show that you have creative thinking. You are a creator. And of course, you are creating things on your own. You have independent thinking. You need to show that you have also some management skills to execute a project that is 5 years and has a big budget. You need to show that you have a leadership. And I repeat, a leadership not only for advanced grants, but also for study grants and consolidator grants. Why? Because as we've seen, one of the key purposes of having ERC is to create the future leaders in research, in global research. So that's why you need to show that. So the ability to propose and conduct groundbreaking research, well, you can do that by showing some evidence. One of the aids is to the ability to propose groundbreaking research. How do you propose groundbreaking research? How you show that? By showing that you have successful records on previous proposals. A nice way to do that is from Marie Curie's Klodowska Actions Individual Fellowships. Now they are called postdoctoral fellowships. But it's important now, but most of the people that are applying now, they should not have any postdoctoral fellowship. They have a Marie Curie individual fellowship. Yeah? So this is something that you need to consider. Or maybe you are submitting any consolidator grant and you have been already successfully completed an ERC standing grant. So this is another thing. or maybe you have applied successfully, made a proposal at the national level, in the National Research Council. Or maybe you were part of the proposal writing team of a successful collaborative project in Horizon 2020, not yet in Horizon Europe, or in FP7 or in FP6, the previous research innovation programs. So this is from the proposal point of view. What about the conduction point of view? You need to show that you have been successfully supervising other researchers, postdoc, PhD students, or even master degree students by supervising their thesis. Even that can be important for an early stage researcher. Or you were the coordinator or a key partner in a collaborative European research project, so you're able to conduct specific research activities. Or maybe you had already some significant publications or deliverables of high value that have been produced. So that's another element that you need to think, and you need to talk about it when you talk about the scientific excellence of yourself as a PI, as a principal investigator. Also, the next thing is any achievements beyond the state of the art. Okay, straightforward things. What is your track record that shows your previous work that contributed to advancing the state of the art in a specific area? For example, whether you've published related research papers in the same scientific domain or outside the scientific domain in highly prestigious publications with high impact number, high impact factor, or you need to show the number of citations that your publications have. These are important elements. Whether you have been receiving an invitation as a lecturer in another university, especially abroad, that can also be a good factor that you need to highlight. Whether you have been received an invitation as a key speaker in scientific conference, and make sure that you highlight all this in your CV. We'll talk a little bit more about that when we are talking about the criteria. And the independent and creative thinking. One thing is that for independent thinking, that you have a number of publications without your PhD supervisor, that you were not only the main author, but you didn't have someone to supervise you for that. That can justify your independent thinking. As a rule of thumb, a rough number can be one significant publication every 1 or 2 years as a rule of thumb, but this is not, I know that in some disciplines, it's not how many publications you publish, but in humanities, social science, for example, you don't have that many publications, but this is just a rule of thumb. Also to show your affiliations or your collaborations that you have with other researchers from universities abroad. So this is something that there is a specific section in the scientific profile of your proposal to show. You show now whether you have creative, which means new and useful, innovative thinking. You can first consider that you have conducted research and highlight that was novel and open new horizons for others. And also whether you supported others, and this is important that is underestimated, to conduct research with high value results. This is also important, not only yourself, but also to show the achievements of people that you have been working and you have been guiding them. What were their achievements in doing that? And of course, you make sure that you highlight all this. Now, regarding the leadership, I would like to make a note of something that I really like. What is leadership? Because many people are confusing that with management, etc. For me, a great leader is one that supports the growth and development of others. So what you need to do is you need to show that you have been supporting the growth and the development of other researchers. This is a great leader in research, the one that supports the growth and the development of other researchers. So you need to highlight that in your proposal. So explain also in the career that you have supervised or trained people in the past that managed to have some startups, or they managed to have some articles of high value published, scientific ones, or you supervised and you guided them and they managed to be members of a collaborative European research project. These are things that you need to think of. advancing the development and growth of other researchers. Now, something regarding the budget, which is good news, that was highlighted this morning, but not that extensively in comparison to Horizon 2020. You will see that in Horizon Europe now, the new ERC calls, we have something like 3 billion euros more. So if we try to translate that into what is the benefit for us, that means that more than 1,450 on average projects, ERC projects, are expected to get funded. That's a lot. In the 7 years time window, of course, from 2021 up to 2027. Which means that 20% more in comparison to Horizon 2020 projects are going to get funded. So this is also something that you need to take advantage of. If you have tried the ERC in Horizon 2020 and you didn't get funded, you went the reserve list or whatever, please make sure that you don't do that. Don't miss any resubmissions by addressing the comments that you received, because now you have by far more chances because of the increase in the budget. Now, the other thing is regarding the panels. There was an exhaustive discussion on how many panels we have, 27, as we've seen this morning, in 3 different disciplines: physical science and engineering. And then we had in life sciences, and then we had in humanities, social sciences and humanities. The only reason that I'm showing this now is to clarify one thing that is very often a misconception. And what is that? The things that you see under the panel, SH11, SH12, SH13, they are not sub-panels. Some people believe that these are sub-panels. So we have one big panel and then you have sub-panels. No, this is not the case. What are these things are keywords. So normally what we have is in each panel, we have 1 or 2 maximum panel members that have a specialization or an expertise in that specific keyword. So, for example, in SH1, which is individuals, markets and organizations, we have one expert that is in possibly in SH11, which is microeconomics, monetary economics, economic growth, and another one expert as panel member that is international trade or international management, international business or special economics. So there is not overlap in many cases. Of course, you might have some experts that they have 2 expertise, different expertise in 2 different disciplines. But as a rule of thumb, we have maximum 2. So 1 or 2 expertise are present in each panel. So this is what you need to remember, and why it is important to remember that, because that affects the evaluation also, as you will see later. And that's a point that I wanted to clarify. Now, there is a map here. In that map, why I have it, it has this, I have created that, it creates the synthesis of the panel members based on the previous years. And why we need to know that? Because as it is, and as it looks so, we have more or less, but not as a rule of thumb, more or less the same panel members repeated every 2 years. So what does that mean? That means that the panel members that were present in 2019, they will be most likely present in 2021, as I said, every 2 years. And the panel members that were in the evaluation 2020, they will be also in the evaluation in 2022. Mm-hmm. And why you need to know that? Well, you need to know that because if you more or less know the synthesis of, let's say, of 2019, and then you guess that more or less the same synthesis will be for the 2021 submission, and by looking at the names, and looking in Big Brother, who is Big Brother? Big Brother is Google. You go there and you check the profiles of the people, you will be able to identify the ones that they will have a specific specialization in a specific keyword from that panel that is responsible for. So then more or less, you will have an well-estimated guess, always a guess, but it's a well-estimated guess, who will be the lead evaluator of your proposal, of your ERC proposal. This is very important to know, because the more you know about the evaluators that will be evaluating your proposal, the better and easier it will be for you to write the proposal in such a way so to explain them the high value of your idea as well as of yourself as a principal investigator. So do that kind of exercise. You can use also the mind map that I showed you before, that you can see the different panel members, and you will see also links to their profile in that mind map. Another thing that is very important was stressed out, but not that clearly this morning, is that when we are selecting in part A, in the administrative part, when we are selecting our panel, we are selecting, first of all, a primary ERC panel, and we have the option of selecting a secondary ERC panel. Never do it. Only select one panel. Why? Even if your research is interdisciplinary research and you believe that has also value to and also gives contributions to other disciplines, there is always one discipline that affects more. This is the one that you need to select, because your panel will not be, your proposal will not be evaluated by two panels if you select also secondary panel, as many PIs believe. It will be only evaluated by one panel, and you face the risk to be evaluated by the wrong panel. If you don't include, if you include also secondary panel. So never do it as a rule of thumb, because there is always one focus in your research idea, even no matter how much multidisciplinary it is, there is always one area that is focusing more. This is the one they're going to use. So this will be the part of the primary ERC review panel. Select only that and not give an option for second. The next thing is the keyword, the ERC keyword that you're going to give. And as we discussed, based on the keyword that you use, then that defines the lead panel evaluator from the primary panel that you have selected. And as we've said, as an exercise, this is important, because you need to make sure that your proposal will be evaluated by the person that has the most appropriate expertise related to your discipline. And another thing that is very often underestimated are the free keywords that have at the bottom. Why these are underestimated? Because these are keywords that you can put, not based on a list. These are the keywords that you need to include based on your research focus. But based on those keywords, these keywords, they are going to define, along with the reference that you have in your proposal, who will be the external evaluators. So the external evaluators of your proposal, the ones that will be part of the panel members, because we've seen this morning we have also external evaluators, they are going to be selected based on the keywords that you have in that box and based on the references. So what do you need to do? So play around with the keywords that you include in that section, in the free keyword section. Why? And play around with the keywords, and then as long as you have specific keywords, go to the Google or Google Scholar and try to see what kind of researchers are popping up based on those keywords. Because by playing around, you might be able to ensure, or at least have higher chances to have your proposal evaluated by the most appropriate expert, the one that comes up, pops up from the search results from Google or from Google Scholar. So it's important, don't underestimate the value of the free keyword section. Now, regarding, that was also related to a question that I raised today to Lily. I would like you to know some statistics about the ERC based on previous course. The first one, of course, you can know the official success rate. What's the official success rate? Is the number of proposals funded over the number of overall proposals submitted. Okay, it's good to know that, but it's not enough. What I would like you to know when you're selecting the panel and when you have a dilemma between which panel to select, because you're going to select only one panel. Check also the actual success rate. What is that? The number of proposals funded over the number of proposals that passed to step two. As we've seen today, this morning, we have a two-step evaluation. So the really good proposals pass to step two, according to the panel members. And you want to know that. Why? Because you want to know what is the success rate among the good proposals, not the overall, because the overall includes also proposals that probably were not good ones. They were submitted for the first time, so they might not be that they might not be of that high quality. And the last thing that I want you to know, is I would like you to know per panel what was the last mark that the last proposal that was funded in ERC received in a specific panel. That was related to the question that I asked to Lily, and she confirmed to me that the national contact points not, but the program committee members or the national contact point coordinator can have that information. So you need to know that. What is that? You need to know how competitive are the proposals in a specific call. So if we have, let's say, in one panel, 10 proposals funded, I would like you to know what was the total mark that the 10th proposal received. Was it 95% out of 100? Was it 85%? Or was it 75%? It's good to know that, because it makes a difference whether the last one that was funded in that panel was receiving 75% or 95%. And if you have a dilemma, which panel to choose, and there is that difference, in some cases there is, not as a rule, as a general rule. So in that case, you need, that will be a thing that you need to take into consideration. I'm not telling you that it's going to be a decisive factor, but it's going to be a point that I would like you to consider when you are choosing the panel. And you need to make sure that you're feeling comfortable with all the different indicators when you're selecting the panel. The first official success rate, you can get it from the ERC proposal website. You have the statistics there. The second one, the actual success rate from the national contact point, they have that. And the third one, either from the panel member or from the national contact point, as we've seen today. And Lily will be able to provide you that kind of information, because she confirmed that to you today. So this is how you get the success rates from the official success rates. So you've seen, you just do a smaller division. So you will see per panel, you see how much is the official success rate. And on average, it varies from 11 plus something to 14 plus something percent. And why is that? Because the ERC tries to balance the success rates between different panels. So depending on the number of proposals that a panel receives, then that derives also the budget that will be allocated to that panel for the proposals to be funded. Why they're doing that? Because they want to make a balance on the the success rate per panel. They don't want to have different, very big differences between panels on the success rate. So the most popular panels, they receive higher budget in order to balance the success rate. Otherwise, it wouldn't be possible. You wouldn't have big differences among the success rates. So the actual success rates, that's an example that you can get from the national contact point, but it's important to know that. So for knowledge is not power. Applied knowledge is power. So you need to have a homework now. You need to, when you see that video, you need to put in your calendar when you're going to contact the national contact point or the research support office from the University of Malta to give you these numbers, these indicators. You need to ask them related to the panels that you're targeting, even if it is in August for the advanced grant, or if it is in January or next year for the starting and the consolidated grant. Now, regarding the another thing that you need to read and understand from the guide for peer reviewers is how evaluation is done. But we've seen that this morning with Alina, so I'm not going to discuss that in more detail. However, What I would like is, I would like very quickly to tell you that we have, to repeat that we have two-step evaluations in ERC. Every panel receives something like 100, 150 proposals. And one proposal is assigned a lead partner and two or three other panel members as co-readers, as co-evaluators. So the lead partner, along with the other co-evaluators, will read the B1 part in detail, and they will decide whether it is worth proceeding to step two for the full evaluation. Each panel member will be a lead evaluator to two or three proposals, and a co-evaluator or a co-reader to 12 from 14 proposals. Why that difference? Because as we said, we have some panels that are very popular, so they receive a lot of proposals. But just to see the amount of proposals that each panel member has to evaluate. As a lead partner, of course, it's 2 to 3 proposals, but as a co-evaluator, 12 to 40 proposals. So they read the proposal and they need to agree, the lead partner, with the co-readers as soon as they have assessed individually the proposal, on their consensus, what should be the mark, and whether it is high, which means A, it passed to the second step evaluation. Second step evaluation means that then the full proposal will be evaluated. You're submitting both parts at the same time, but only one part of the proposal, B1, is evaluated at the step one, and the full proposal will be evaluated at the step two. So as a rule of thumb, as we've seen also this morning, sometimes 3 times more than the expected proposals that should be funded will pass to step two. And before going to the step two, the lead partner suggests the potential external referees, external evaluators that should be involved in step two to evaluate the proposal. And then when we have the step two, then each panel evaluates now around 20 to 40 proposals. And this proposal is, the full proposal is again evaluated by the leader and the co-evaluators. Plus, we have also external reviewers that they have been suggested by the leader to evaluate the proposal. These are not members of the panel. These are not members of the ERC Scientific Council. These are just experts, specialists in the domain, and they were selected based on the keywords that you included in your Part A proposal, plus the reference that you have included in your grant application. So all the proposals in step two will be invited to an interview. And as a rule of thumb, half of them will receive an A, and 20% of the proposals that pass will get granted. Not all the ones that receive A, as we've seen this morning, will get funded. And then we have the panel members, along with the leader and the co-readers, that are going to discuss your proposal during the interview section. Of course, you might expect questions from the leader, the one that was mainly assigned and responsible for your proposal, but don't get surprised if you receive also questions from other panel members. We've seen this, so I'm not going to talk about the restrictions on when you can apply, but you need to make sure that your proposal is of high quality in order to be able to resubmit it if it doesn't get funded, because this is something that we've seen also this morning. Now, the other thing now, based now that you know how the evaluation is run, you need to understand one thing. We have mainly two parts, regarding the technical description of your proposal. We have part B1 and we have part B2. However, part B1, you need to make it more general. Why? Because it's not going to be evaluated by specialists. It's going to be evaluated by some members of the panel member, and these are called generalists. These one or two, these from two to three panel members. On the other hand, B2 is going to be evaluated by some generalists, which are panel members, but also by some specialists. These are the external reviewers that have been invited based on your references and based on your keywords. And this is why you need to make sure that B1 is different than B2. Alina this morning said that one of the most popular reasons to fail in one proposal is similar B1 and B2. So I don't know whether you can remember that, but that was an important comment. This is what exactly what is reflected here. You need to write B1 for generalists, the ones that they don't have a specialization, and then you need to write B2 for the ones that they have concrete specialization. They probably know as much as you know regarding, you need to assume that they know as much as you know regarding the research topic that you're addressing. The other thing that I would like, and that was raised by one of the successful applicants in the panel today, this morning, is to look on previously funded projects related to your research topic. So if your research topic was dealing with tumorigenesis, let's say, then you go to ERC, you go to the previously funded projects, and you try to find out other successful applicants related to the same topic as yours. And if you can recall, they said, contact them, share your idea, ask them to, if possible, to give you, if they're willing, their proposal application to see how they've written a proposal that was successful in the same domain that you were targeting. So you just go here, for example, in tumorigenesis, you have Martin Ehlers. So you go to Big Brother again. You try to find out the contact details of Martin Ehlers by just putting his affiliation and then the ad symbol to Big Brother. And immediately you will see that you will get the contact details of that person. Phone number and email address. Contact them. Ask them whether they're willing to share your idea, whether they would like to give you some tips, whether they can evaluate your proposal, or they can give you their proposal for seeing how they have written it in a similar scientific domain as yours. So this is step one. This is regarding the intelligence. I don't know, do we have any questions? Yes?
Hello. So I'd like to ask, thanks, of course, for the presentation so far. I'd like to ask if there are big changes between Horizon 2020 and Horizon Europe, between these two frameworks, regarding the template of the ERC and the proposal writing.
No, there aren't. Exactly the same. Okay. The structure is exactly the same. The concept is exactly the same. What is the change? Is the budget. More budget in Horizon Europe than in Horizon 2020.
Okay, thank you.
Welcome. Do you have any other questions from the chat facility?
I can ask the question. It was the change is from the excellent science to the open science, right? The pillar one is now called open science instead of excellent science. Is it reflected in something that changed in the procedures?
Pillar one now is called excellent science. Now, in Horizon Europe. So it doesn't make any sense. Still, you need to make sure that your research is going to be as open as possible, as it was also in Horizon 2020. No, that's the problem. So there's no any difference between those, Horizon 2020 and Horizon Europe in Pillar one. For ERC. We have some changes regarding Marie Curie, which is part of Pillar 1, but not regarding ERC specifically. It doesn't make any difference. It still has to be excellent.
The dilemma for me with an ERC was always like, because you mentioned it, it has to be something new you haven't done before, and you don't know where it will lead. At the same time, evaluators need reassurance that the project is doable. Like, it was, I remember once we had a case where the idea was great, but it was shut down because it was not known what was going to be found. So how do you present that, and how can you be convincing that it's worth pursuing?
Yes, that's a common question. So in that case, you need to have a very ambitious research idea that is will lead to a known result. You don't know whether you will achieve the overall expectation, but at the same time, you need to have concrete key intermediate goals. Your groundbreaking objectives have to be achieved. And the groundbreaking objectives, they should be of low risk, not of high risk. So that means that even at the very end, even if you don't manage to complete fully that research idea because you are exploring unknown territories, at the same time, you will be able to concrete some key results, intermediate goals, key intermediate goals. And this should be fully feasible and achievable. So that's the only way. Any other thing? No? Okay, I think we're running a little bit out of time. So we will see how much we will manage to complete. Maybe we'll need one more session for module 3. We will see to contact it visually. So let's see now the full proposal development cycle of an ERC proposal. So we need to see the full proposal development cycle as traffic lights. We need to go from I to C, from C to R, from R to E, from E to A, from E to E, and then repeating, because the more we repeat, the better we become. And only when the traffic light is green. Whenever it is red, we stop until we make it green. And if it's yellow, we can proceed, but with caution. And we can have an accident. We don't know. So it's better to have always make sure that we pass to each one of those different stages with a green traffic light. So the first element, and for me, I'm very pleased that we have the time to discuss about that, is the I. And the I is how to make a great idea. Because the idea is the foundation of a great proposal, ERC proposal. So the stronger the foundation is, the higher can be the value of the proposal. So this is something that we need to understand. And what makes an ERC proposal a great one? Well, an idea, a great one. First of all, it needs to be aligned with the mission and the vision of the researcher. The mission is needs to be fully aligned of what the researcher is doing now and why they're doing it. And also the vision, where you see yourself as a researcher in a minimum 5 years from now. Where do you see yourself? And how your project, your ERC idea is going to support that vision. And that will be reflected also, mission and vision will be reflected in the profile of when you describe the profile of the principal investigator in B1, B and C. The third thing, that in order to have a great idea, as we said, it needs to address, you need to identify a key scientific challenge or problem. We need to have that. And it needs to create new and useful knowledge, forefront knowledge, as we call it, new and useful. It needs to be unique and to give, to show the pathway for new discoveries, for other researchers from the same discipline, from other disciplines, to take your results. So that's why we have it open science, to take your results and exploit them, take advantage, make something new out of them, make themselves some discoveries. Is challenging to be fully achieved, highly ambitious, so it's a high gain, but at the same time, high risk. But at the same time, not possible to be implemented by others now. And how can we show that? How can we show that? We need to show that we have an advantage. And the advantage can be justified based on preliminary findings, based on previous publications that you have done. So to show that, yes, you are the best researcher for implementing that idea. And I hear in some trainings that I conduct on ERC, but I am very shy to share my idea with others, or I don't trust to share my idea with others because it might be stolen. And the immediate question that follows, the immediate remark that follows after that is, if you are afraid that your idea can be stolen by others, then it is not for ERC. Because you should be the one, the most appropriate one for conducting the idea. If there is someone else that can conduct the same idea as you, then it's not for ERC immediately. So for me, that's a very easy answer. I can understand immediately when we are talking about a great ERC proposal or not, by seeing when they are afraid to share their idea or not. If they are afraid to share it, then it's not for ERC. Because why? You're not the most appropriate one for doing it. Not because you thought about the one idea that makes you the most appropriate person. You need to show that with your preliminary findings, with your access to specific research infrastructures that no one else has, with previous publications that you have conducted and make you unique on that. If you don't have those, then this is not for you. This ERC is not for funding that idea. That's simple. So how to create innovative ideas? Well, we need to identify a big problem, a big challenge. And I would like to quote what Albert Einstein said, that if his life was depending on the solution of one problem, and they were giving him one time to find answer to that problem, then he will be spending 50 minutes, 50, for understanding the problem and 10 minutes for giving the answer. Exactly that important is our approach when we're dealing with an ERC. We need to identify what is the key problem, what we're missing, what is the key challenge, what kind of knowledge we're missing now, and what are the consequences of that. So this is important. So there is also another mind map here. I'm not going to go through that. We're running a little bit out of time. So these are things that you need to ask while you are creating your idea. But the important thing, as I said, is to try to identify a key challenge and why this is a key challenge by providing justifications. And this is very well related to the state of the art analysis. Now, the C element is connections. This is what I said before. Don't be afraid to share your idea. So you have by now 3-4 sentences that you have internally validated by yourself, by some people in your research team. Now you go outside your research community. You go to other researchers, you try to share that idea because you want to externally validate the high value of your idea. And if you are afraid to do that, then stop here. That's a red traffic light. Don't go on. Don't spend more time on ERC. Spend it in Marie Curie postdoc fellowships. Spend it in writing a publication. Spend it in academic tasks, but not on ERC. Things that you need to connect, of course, is with the ERC National Contact Point. You have here as University of Malta a very active NCP in Marie Curie, but also in ERC. Lily, that will be is helping you to take advantage of here. And the other thing that was suggested also by one of the panel members this morning is to connect with successful applicants in similar topic as yours. And we've seen already an example how we can do that. We've gone to the ERC database, we identify the name, then base, we go to Google Brother, we find them email address, and then we contact them. We make sure that we contact them by email and then by phone. And I will insist a little bit on that because it's important how we're going to approach that person. First of all, we need to have the mentality not ask and shall receive, but give and shall receive. Ask and shall receive is something that we used to have in the Bible. It's nice for religious purposes, but not for scientific purposes. For scientific purposes and for social connection, we need to give and you shall receive. So you send an email to someone and you start with an honest compliment. That is it going to be regarding his or her ERC project? Is it going to be about a publication that they have published? Is it going to be about a prize that they recently won? It's up to you to find out what, but give an honest compliment regarding that. Elaborate that you have already key expertise and your key activities in the research topic of your ERC. And then give something else apart from the compliment. If possible, try to to see whether you can help that person, right? To see whether you can act as a peer reviewer in some of his or her publications, or you can act as an advisory board member in their project. But try to give some value. And then express your plan to submit an ERC proposal. Yes, it's better now. Whether they are willing to give you some feedback. This is important on that. Now you can ask it. Don't start immediately with number four. Give something first and then go to number four in your email. And don't expect them to tell you, yes, we can give you some support or we can give you some advice or not. The scope of your email should be to have a virtual meeting with them of 10, 15 minutes, just to know each other better. And then you can discuss further how and whether they can contribute to your project. If you don't get any a response, follow up. Send a second email, then follow up by phone. Never send an email to anyone without expecting to do whatever it takes for getting a response. Because otherwise, don't send that email. It's not like gambling, and the more emails you send, the more answers you get to receive back. No, you need to be determined, fully determined to get a response. And at the very end, even if they don't have a collaboration with you in an ERC context, then at least you extend your network with things like individuals in the same research as yours. Now, as a homework, second one, I want you to create your own list of factors that are active in the same key research topic. Maybe you do know them, maybe you don't know them, but maybe you have never written them somewhere. You need to have them somewhere, and you have their contact details, as we've seen, and they can be advisors of your ERC proposal idea, of your summary, of your B1, of your B1 and B2, advisors or experts, or even collaborators in your ERC project. So there are many different collaboration opportunities that you can have. Make sure that you examine them. But first of all, as a starting point, you need to create a list of potential collaborators in the similar research topic. So this is what should be your homework, number two. So as soon as we complete that list of people that we can connect, then we can go to the next step, which is R. And R is to read. Read now all the different documents that exist in the ERC website, of course, the call, the work program, the information for applicants, the information for peer reviewers. Something that hasn't been mentioned so far, and I would like to raise it, is spotlight on ERC projects. This is very important. There are spotlights related to different research topics, climate, digital, and etc. Why? Because you will see in a written friendly way how research is described. So you can take some ideas and see how you can describe your research to generalists, to panel members that they don't have any expertise specifically on your research topic. So that can be a nice inspiration, as well also having a look on previously related projects, as we've seen. Check the frequently asked questions for questions that have been raised related to your either panel or to your ERC in general. And as soon as you read all this different material, make sure that you have prepared a summary, not of your proposal idea, but of your call topic description, of you, a well-structured two-page summary of the ERC call topic. So the eligibility criteria, you do know them, but just in case. The submission deadline, you may forget it, just have it. The evaluation criteria, the key document that you would like to consider, further to the ones that we've discussed before. Previously funded projects, similar to your project idea. Success rates, we've seen that we have three success indicators that we need to have, and contact details of your national contact point of Lilly or of your research support staff, and we'll be willing to give you some further advice on that. Okay, we've discussed how we have the outcomes, and then E, as soon as we prepare the call topic summary, is the summary, encapsulate. What does that mean? That means that we need to make sure that we describe our proposal idea in a more elaborated way in 2 or 3 pages. So this is the proposal summary. Now, you can use, I have a mind map here as an example that you can use it for preparing a proposal summary. I call it the Canvas tool. And this Power Canvas tool is based on specifying in your proposal summary what is your purpose, so your key research question, what are the objectives, the groundbreaking objectives, what is your work plan, your scientific approach, what are the economics, which means the resources and the time scale, and what are your own value, the researcher's value. So this is the Power Canvas. And if you go to that mind map here, you will see also an example of a winning proposal, how they have completed the different elements regarding purpose, objectives, work plan, economics, and researchers' value. So, homework number 3, you have to do a lot before you submit the proposal in ERC, is to prepare your ERC proposal summary as soon as you have, of course, an idea, and you can use the Power Canvas template for doing it. Where can we use that proposal summary? Well, we use the proposal summary for getting feedback from regarding our ERC project, from fellows in our team, outside our team, from the national contact point, from the research support team. It's important to have that. And then also to engage some expert as collaborators in your proposal, or for helping you building B1, the general synopsis regarding your project. And of course, by being the starting point for your section B2, which is the section that is directed to specialists. And you are, in some cases, you might need the proposal summary for engaging resources. In some universities, they might want to release you from some academic tasks if the supervisor of yours, in order to, if you're applying for an ERC proposal, so they can have a substitute, so you can dedicate yourself to your ERC proposal, and you might need the proposal summary to do that. And as we've seen also for getting a national support scheme, that's another use here in Malta, you can submit your proposal, I guess, for getting some funding, for getting external support or coaching or consultancy in your proposal. And as soon as we prepare the proposal summary, then we can go to the next step. And the next step is attract the best team. So we need to understand what kind of researchers we have, competent researchers, direct or indirect ones. Direct are the ones that are part of your team. Yes. They're going to be experts, collaborators, that their contribution is going to be funded from the project. But they can be also indirect ones. They can be ones that they are stakeholders or they have strong interest or good knowledge regarding your research topic. So they can act as advisors. So they can have an advisory role in your project. So we call them indirect team members. And we attract competent team members and sources, of course, for that is the first one is our own network, good one. And the second one is, if we don't have a good network yet, there are no excuses, we can look from previously funded projects, ERC projects, related to our key research topic, and then we find actors that have been successful and we try to engage them as we showed before. Now, another thing that I would like to, and this also will cover the criteria formula that we will not discuss apparently today because we're running out of time. But if you go to Open ERC platform, this is a platform that I have created, is openerc.eu. This is a step-by-step online platform that guides you how to write the each subsection in B1 and B2. It is very important. It's based on feedback and contributions that we have received from successful applicants in ERC. So these people, they share their proposal, they share their knowledge, and based on the feedback that we received, we created a step-by-step guidance how to create a full ERC application. And it is very important because it gives examples. It gives examples, schematic ones. It gives examples how to write it. It gives examples on the structure. So it's important to go through in order to transform an empty grant application into a successful ERC proposal. The best advice that I can give you is go to the Open ERC. I repeat, there is the link here, is openerc.eu. Now, it is free access, but it's only accessible for people that are from a university or from a research institution. It's not from third parties outside. So when you're registering, make sure in order to validate your access that you register with your university email address. Because if you use your Gmail or Yahoo, your registration will not pass the validation stage, because it's only available exclusively to researchers. The value is very high. More than 500 people are using it, researchers, and the feedback that we receive is amazing. So make sure that you follow that. And the last element, and this actually will conclude my presentation, is that you need to evaluate the final draft. The final draft, we have already received some feedback on how to evaluate them, the proposal idea, by sharing our idea with internals and externals. The other thing that we need to have fully evaluated is the final draft of our proposal. So what does that mean? That means that we need to have an external. Why an external? Someone that hasn't been involved in writing the proposal. Why someone that hasn't been involved? Because otherwise he or she will be biased. So we need an external one to go through the proposal and provide you feedback. If necessary, paragraph per paragraph. And always be open to critical comments. The more critical comments you receive, the more space for improvement you will have. So that external person can be a colleague, can be your ERC support office, can be an already successful applicant in ERC, or it can be an external expert with a fee. And we've seen that there is also that kind of funding that you can have here in Malta for engaging an expert with a fee. And the output now is the proposal ready to be submitted. You receive the comments 2 weeks, 10 days before the submission deadline. So whenever you have a submission deadline, create immediately an internal submission deadline 10 days before the official one. So that means that 10 days before, you need to have already completed the full proposal at your best. And as soon as you complete the proposal 10 days before the submission, then you ask someone external to go through it in 1 or 2 days and give you critical feedback. And then it gives you a week to work on the comments that you have received. This is very important because it is they go through each of the criteria, they identify the weaknesses, and of course they can give you some feedback, not only the final draft, but in previous stages, as we discussed, either in the proposal summary or related to the proposal idea. So now you submit the final proposal, you send a thank you message to all the partners that help you, to all the team members that help you. You tidy up your office and any folders, because everything will be in a mess. And last but not least, you celebrate. This is very important for two reasons. First of all, because you celebrate because you are working on your dream project. ERC is your dream project. And even if it is not successful, it was a nice journey that allowed you to learn a lot of things regarding the state of the art and regarding what the others are doing. So this is important. And the second, you want to celebrate because as soon as you celebrate, then you train your brain to start liking writing an ERC proposal. And it is important to do that for improvement. Even if you fail the first time, your mind will say to you, okay, we will try the next time by learning, by receiving the comments from the evaluators, and we will have the energy. And you will not know why you would like to write again an ERC proposal. Well, one of the reasons is because you celebrate it at the end of your submission to have that psychological. So this is just a timeline, when we start to work on our ERC project, so something, if T0 is the submission deadline, then 1 week before the submission deadline, we need to have the evaluations of the external person. Then 1 month and a half, we need to start writing the proposal. 2 months before, we need to have the team ready that we will be working with. 2.5 months, as a rule of thumb, you need to have your proposal summary ready. 3 months, you need to have fully read the related material. 4 months before, you need to start connecting and raising awareness regarding your idea and getting feedback. And something that is more than 4 months before the submission deadline, you need to work on that breakthrough concept, breakthrough idea. And these are the traffic lights that you need to go through on that. And if I need to say one thing, if you write an excellent, to your view, ERC proposal, and you don't connect with anyone to share feedback, to share your idea, to have someone externally evaluating your final draft or your summary, you will reach 60% of its maximum capacity. So do you want to reach 100%? Make sure that you connect for attracting the best team members, for attracting collaborators, for having a feedback regarding your idea, your proposal summary, or your final draft. It is important, and that's the way that you pass. And we complete here step two, and we have to stop. And I repeat, criteria formula as it is this reflected also on the open.erc platform. So thank you for your attention. I hope that that was useful. Very intense. Apologies that we didn't complete it fully, the recipe, but I think that you have more than enough to deal now with ERC successfully for the upcoming deadlines. Thank you for your attention. Any questions that we have? No? Okay. No?
It's just a comment on the sea of connect, because the more you connect, the more you establish yourself in the community, and anyone you connect with is a potential expert evaluator in this area, because you're in a similar field, right? So if you're connecting to someone who will then maybe see or hear about this proposal or whatever as an acting evaluator at some other point in your life, that's the power of networking.
Or one thing that we need to bear in mind, this is very important. On the other hand, if you don't want one specific individual to evaluate your proposal, just for your information, you can express your willingness to be excluded from the evaluation. If it's going to be considered by the panel, your claim to be excluded or not is another issue, but you can have that, because in some cases, we are in a competitive research community, so you might don't want your proposal to be evaluated by another person that you're not that well connected with. This is still possible.